Would you say that a computer, you know, that a very complex computer, is it, would you say that's something that's able to think, you know, have these stream of cognitive functions? Or would you say that, oh, like consciousness is only limited to biological material and not something like a microchip?
It's a very good question. Well, it depends what you mean by thinking. So if mm-hmm. thinking, you relate it to meaning, and to meaning, you relate to intentionality, then computers mm-hmm. don't do anything like that. Computers are just about syntactical arrangements. So the basis of all computer programs are zeros and ones. So it's based on mm-hmm. syntax, in other words, symbols. It's just a rearrangement of zeros and ones. Do these zeros and ones, are they aware of their own zero and one? And or are they aware of something outside of themselves, right? Do they have an ability to attach meaning to the symbols? Mm. And that's a kind of interesting argument in consciousness. So, you know, as Brother Sharif mentioned earlier, he eloquently talked about the kind of computer system and the zeros and ones. And when it comes to computer systems, the problem that you have is that really you need a mind to interpret the zeros and ones anyway. You need an external mind to do that. And that's why William Hasker, he makes a really good point. He basically says that computer programs or computer systems are just a protraction of human consciousness anyway, of human rationality anyway, right? So can computers think like us? Of course not. Can they do kind of abstract reasoning based on the syntactical arrangements and come up with, you know, very fast kind of solutions to complicate algorithms? For sure. Can computers be seemingly more intelligent than humans in this particular way? 100%. Mm-hmm. They're already showing this. But what do you mean by thinking? If you're talking about meaning and intentionality as well, which is the kind of, you know, the conscious stream of thoughts, right? Then absolutely not. Because let me show you what I mean by making a distinction between syntactical and semantic arrangements. So for example, let me give you three sentences in language. Se agaboboli, seni chok sevirum. And I love you a lot. So that's Greek, Turkish, and English, okay? They all have the same meaning, which is, I love you a lot. Now, say you only know English. If I give you the Greek alphabet and I tell you to put sigma, which is the S, sigma, epsilon, right, which is like the E, then have a space, and I tell you, take the alpha and put it here. Take the gamma, put it next to the alpha. Take the alpha again, put it next to the gamma. So I could train you on, without even talking about meaning, on arranging those symbols in a particular way. By virtue of you knowing how to arrange those symbols in a particular way, it will never give rise to the meaning of I love you a lot. You just never know, because you'll have no way of attaching the meaning to those symbols, right? So that's an interesting distinction to make between syntactic and semantic arrangements. And computer programs are very similar. They're based on basically zeros and ones fundamentally. And even when you talk about machine learning and all of these crazy beautiful terms that you learn about now in artificial intelligence, it's still reduced to zeros and ones arranged in a particular way.
Yeah.
So just to wrap this up, Professor John So developed a really powerful thought experiment. He was on a plane, I think, when he was thinking about this. And it's called the Chinese Room Experiment. And he wants to make a distinction between strong AI and weak AI, which is the kind of distinction that we're making now. Can computers really think like we do, kind of thing? And the Chinese Room Experiment, in summary, is this. You have someone in a room, and there are Chinese speakers outside of the room. And the Chinese speakers are giving questions in Chinese to the person in the room. The person in the room does not know Chinese, but they do have an English rule book. And the English rule book is telling him, when you see a squiggly thing plus another squiggly thing that looks like this, then give some cards out to the people outside of the room that include these squiggly things. So he's got a rule book that teaches them how to look at the shapes and the syntactic arrangement of the symbols and shapes of Chinese, the characters. And the rule book tells them, if you see this type of kind of arrangement, then give them these characters. Now, the people outside of the room, every time they ask a question, they're getting the right answer. So the people outside the room who know Chinese, they think the person in the room actually knows Chinese, but he doesn't. Mm-hmm. He just has an English rule book that helps him deal with the kind of syntactic arrangements, not the semantic arrangements, because he has no way of adding semantics to syntax, right? So that shows that the computer system can do complex symbolic arrangements or syntactic arrangements, but there's no way of attaching meaning to the symbols. Now, one would argue, there is a reply to this. It's called the system's reply. And one would argue is, well, doesn't the whole system know the meaning? Well, what does that mean? There is no way of the system attaching meaning to the symbols in any shape or form. Even if the rule book was in the person's head, they would still not know Chinese, the meaning of those words. Right?
Yeah. Okay.